Okay, back to the problems. And in particular, problem 3.6 is where we got to. Assume two resources, C and D, used in quantities C and D, with associated stocks of factor augmenting knowledge AC and AD. The augmented resources ACC and ADD are perfect substitutes for one another. Assume that the stocks of knowledge grow independently, and furthermore, assume that it's easier to boost D augmenting knowledge than it is to boost C augmenting knowledge, it should say. Okay. So we're kind of focusing totally on the research sector in this question. But if we wanted to get a picture of the overall model, we could have something like this, right? Where you have these two potential inputs as well as labor into the final goods sector. And we could think of these inputs as being sort of extracted or produced using final goods. So some of what's produced here goes to consumption, some goes to extracting these inputs, and then these go in here. But we also have some labor going off to the research sector, coming up with new knowledge, AC and AD, or better knowledge. Because in here we've got inputs of ACC and ADD, that's the effective inputs of C and D. So if we can raise AC or AD, we're getting more value for the physical inputs. And these two are perfect substitutes here. So the production function here is like Y of, say, is like ALL to the 1 minus alpha, and then ACC plus ADD to the alpha, say. So then these are perfect substitutes, you just add them together. Okay. But we don't need any of that actually to answer the question. But it still might be good to have it in the back of your mind that there's some economy, something like this, going on in the background of this question. And it's crucial that these are perfect substitutes. Assume that the stocks of knowledge grow independently. So AC and AD grow independently of one another. Furthermore, assume it's easier to boost D augmenting knowledge than it is to boost C augmenting. Write down appropriate knowledge production functions. So it could be, for instance, ACT plus 1 is phi times ACT times ZCT. I used phi again. Let's call it alpha C, whatever. Okay. And ADT plus 1 is alpha D ADT ZDT to the phi. Okay. We haven't talked too much about what's an appropriate formulation for these. So various things would be okay. But we want this multiplicative effect of the investment on the new knowledge. Okay. And they have to grow independently of each other, which means ACT plus 1 depends on ACT and ZCT, but not at all on, for instance, ADT. Okay. So, something like that would be fine. Knowledge knowledge stocks are equal at time zero, but resource D is slightly cheaper than resource C, and it remains so for 100 years. Okay. So, WD is less than WC. Furthermore, I think we were told it's easier to boost D augmenting knowledge than it is to boost C augmenting knowledge. So alpha D must be greater than alpha C, right? For a given investment here, you get a bigger growth in AD than if you have the same investment here, given that alpha C is smaller. Okay. So if you've got perfect substitutes, AC and AD are equal, D is cheaper than C, you're going to go with D, aren't you? Furthermore, it's easier to boost AD over time. Oh, I've gone between small and large letters here, never mind. So you're going to go totally with the D sector, aren't you? Why bother with the C sector? Of course, the government, the state might have other ideas, seeing a big picture, but the firms, if the state's not doing anything, the firms are going to go all in the D. They're going to put all their investment here and none here. And AD is going to grow. Okay. So describe in words how the economy develops. Well, you use pure D, no C, AD grows, AC. It depends actually on the formulation here. According to this, AC would fall to zero. We could also have had, which is a bit unrealistic because the knowledge should sort of still be there. So a better formulation might have been AC times ACT plus 1 is ACT times 1 plus ZCT, which is really a better formulation. Alpha C, and then this will be alpha D. ADT 1 plus ZDT would be a better formulation. Then, if ZC was zero, complicated stuff. We should really bring this AC, alpha C, inside. Alpha D. So then, if ZC is zero, you just get AC constant. It doesn't grow. And if ZC is positive, it grows. So, if you formulated it that way, you would have AD constant. Either way would be absolutely fine. If you'd gone with the first way, it would be a bit... You'd get this slightly counterintuitive result. Or unintuitive. Okay, so it's very straightforward anyway. You use only D and no C, AD grows, AC constant. In period 6, the regulators in this economy realizes that consumption of D is seriously damaging the environment. What should the regulator do? Okay. So if this is a serious problem, what can we do about it? Well, the way the model is set up, there's only one way of dealing with this problem, which is to stop using D and switch to C. But if we, depending on how serious the environmental damage is, it could be that we don't want to make this switch straight away because C is now, you know, at 100 years of using D, C is a lot less productive. This might be extremely costly in terms of GDP to switch to C. Effectively, with a hill, we're way down here on the dirty side. So, it could be that we want to do a lot of research first before we actually make the switch to the clean input, to bring the clean input price down. So, we could direct research into the C sector, for instance, through a research subsidy to this type of research, until such point as we've brought the C augmenting knowledge up to a level such that we think it's actually worth making the switch. Okay. That's the model. It's not in the question, but there's some huge problems with this model. Okay. One of them is that the knowledge stocks just don't work this way. If this was the case, we've had 100 years of fossil dominance, you'd expect massive, massive fossil, a massive 100-year lead of fossil technology over clean technology. It should take, according to these equations, 100 years of clean research to bring the clean up to speed. Whereas in fact, both clean and fossil energy knowledge are building on labor-augmenting knowledge to a huge extent, general knowledge from the rest of the economy. That means that if we, as soon as we start investing in clean, when this is very large, because we're in the modern economy, the growth in clean knowledge can be very rapid. Of course, we see this with wind technology and solar technology. As soon as we start investing, within 5 or 10 years, the costs are coming way down, because we can suddenly quickly start applying this knowledge. But then, once we've like applied the knowledge that there is around, further increases in clean knowledge to bring this price of ACC down even more are very hard to achieve. So it's almost the opposite of this situation. Here it's like, if you let the system go over here a long way, it's incredibly hard to come back. But at least there's no limit. If you just work at it, you'll get there. Whereas in fact, if you do nothing for a long time, you can achieve very rapid results because of this. This is low and this is very high. But quickly you'll have diminishing returns to those investments, and it'll be hard in the long run. The returns to big investments here are going to dry up. Okay. So, it's not enough to just get firms to put money into research. And then you can let the ball go and it'll roll off onto the clean side. If clean energy is intrinsically more expensive than dirty, which it probably is, then you need to tax the emissions you need to go in tax. We're back to the standard theory. And maybe you need a bit of research subsidization as well. But the Pigodian tax is going to do the whole job, most of the job for you, because it's both incentivizing firms to switch to clean and incentivizing them to invest in clean knowledge. Okay, enough on that.